Welcome to the Thursday, March 22nd, 2012, Goffstown Planning Board meeting. I want to welcome everybody this evening. Just go around the room and introduce members at the table, starting with Brian.
I'm Brian Rose, I'm the Planning and Zoning Administrator.
Phil Devanza, Selectman.
John Heichel.
Mark Warden.
Gail LeBrecq, Recording Secretary.
Alan Yaton.
Tim Redmond, Vice Chair.
Now, do we have any business items that we want to take care of? We want to take care of that. What I would like to do is this. Since I'm kind of a lame duck chairman here, I'm going to take and recuse myself and let our vice chair assume control of this evening's meeting. Timothy.
Thank you, Alan. Okay, well, first we'll start with some minutes. We did not approve minutes at the last meeting from February 23rd.
Motion to approve February minutes.
Motion by Phil to approve.
February minutes.
February 23rd minutes. Anybody want to second that?
I'll second.
Nope.
Seconded by Alan. Do we have any discussion on the minutes? Seeing none, I'll ask for a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions?
Yes. Warden abstains.
And I also abstain because I was not at the February 23rd meeting.
Motion to approve the March minutes.
Second.
Okay. Motion from Phil, seconded by Mark for the March 8th minutes. Any corrections or additions to the minutes? Seeing none, I'll ask for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Chair votes yes. Second item, second action item number two. Could you please just bring that to our attention?
Yes. And Mr. Chair and members of the board, this is the Dearborn Village project.
Oh. I was talking about under action items, Brian.
Oh, sorry. Yes. Mr. Chair, members of the board, Mr. Collis Adams, our one of our planning board members, has turned in a resignation letter. This is basically, I think, kind of a technicality, just due to the recent voting results and a submission of a request to recount because of the closeness of the voting results on planning board members. And due to the fact that Collis would have still been considered an acting member until his position was filled, and not wanting to have him have a dual selectman's rep on the planning board at the same time. You can't do that. So rather than having Collis and Phil acting as planning board members and selectman rep, he was asked to put in the letter of resignation to the planning board so that could evenly go through. So that's why you're seeing that letter.
All right. Do we need to have a formal vote to accept the letter, or is that not necessary?
I think that would be appropriate.
Yes.
We do that in other instances.
I thought so. Okay, well, I'll ask for a motion on that matter.
So moved.
By Mark, seconded by?
I'll second.
Seconded by Phil. And that motion is to accept Collis's letter of resignation. Collis Adams. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Chair votes in affirmative. Thank you, Brian. We have one item on the agenda tonight that is going to be discussed at another night. Brian, could you, let's go to that right now so that if anybody's here to listen to it, they won't waste their time being here.
Okay, Mr. Chair and members of the board, the item listed under other business on your agenda is discussion on outdoor night lighting and at St. A's College Athletic Field, map 3, lot 41. There is a complaint that has come through from Mr. James Alger. He's planning on coming to the planning board and presenting his complaint to you. He wanted to come tonight. However, they are looking to do some additional testing from both noise and lighting professionals to actually bring in some test results, hopefully, to the planning board. And so they want to have time to do that prior to coming in with their complaints. So the attorney, John Cronin, asked to just put that on for another time when they're ready to do that. So,
is that a matter for the board?
Well, I believe that it is. The planning board approved the site plan, and they're questioning whether or not the planning board acted in a manner, I guess, according to the law. So they're wanting to bring that up. So
okay. So if anybody was here for that, it will be. Do you have a date certain for that, Brian?
I do not. And it's not a public hearing technically, so it's, you don't have to continue it or anything like that. We're just, it's kind of like public comment type scenario.
So you'll just let us know when it's coming up?
I would question whether that's not a public matter.
All right. Phil?
Just a technical question on this. When we approve a site plan, is 30 days for an appeal, isn't there?
There is.
Have we passed that process?
We have.
That time frame?
Yes.
Has St. A's...
I think the other half of that is, you know, if it is kind of determined to be a nuisance because of an approval, you know, the planning board has always kind of reserved the right to revisit. And so that's maybe what this would fall under, is having that right to revisit.
Well, I guess...
But in order to decide to revisit, the planning board would have to understand what the issue is. And so I think that's why he's wanting to come and present his issue.
But
Just
to follow up on that, though, I guess the approval that we gave for St. A's, did they need any permits? Did they need anything after they got the approval from us to go forward with their lighting?
Building permit.
Did they receive it? Did they apply? Did they take out a permit?
Yeah.
So they've taken out a permit. I guess the question I have, is this the proper process? Because the reason I'm asking that is, what is the planning board supposed to do from that? And does that mean that every time we give an approval that's gone beyond the 30 days, that the applicants take out their permits, that somebody can come to the planning board?
I don't know. I don't think it does, but, you know, I think this is maybe a special circumstance.
Okay. Alan?
Well, during that public hearing process, all the abutters were notified. That particular abutter did make no appearance, asked no questions, reference this application. We saw lighting data from the proposed lighting for that stadium as part of their approval, and this board approved it. As far as I would think, this is civil action if he has any comment at all. Period.
Well, the only thing I might like to say, Phil, is if they did take their permit and 30 days later was the end of any appeal period, the lights were not up and operational within 30 days, so you really don't know if the college is meeting their design requirements as stated to the board. That's the only area that would be. You don't know if the lights are spilling over until after they're up. You wouldn't know as part of just discussing it here at the table.
I understand. I mean, we did get a letter. We have two letters. We have a letter from, I believe, who designed it or if they're installed. But I guess the question, though, that I have is I understand that we don't know when if that the applicant could take out the permit within 30 days, but this has been, we're beyond that point, is the point that I'm making. And I just am questioning this process.
John?
When the lights go up and the building permit has been, when the application has happened, the lights go up, is there a process for someone to go out and check the lights to make sure that they conform with the plans that we approved? And who is that person or who is that?
What we would do is ask the consulting engineer that gave us the plan to affirm that the lighting was installed in accordance with the plan, and we rely on their professional opinion.
And we did that?
I don't know that.
I did ask the engineers for that, and I think that's one of the letters
that you've
gotten.
That's the letter we're referring to.
In your packet.
Yeah, there was something in our packet about that.
Okay. We also had a letter from Father Moore.
So at this point, the board needs to decide whether we're going to have this discussion or not.
Well, that's a good point, because if it's too late, we can't do anything, right? Even if he complains, even if we think that's valid, it's too late to unwind it, right?
Well,
can't retroactively take the permit from college, can you?
Well, I know that in past practice, after we do an approval, if a problem comes up, we always have the right to revisit the site plan to make sure that it's in compliance. Phil?
Well, the letter that we received is apparently from, it says, dear Mr. Furlong, I'm in writing to confirm that we tested the light levels both on and off Proponi Field to determine if the lighting system was performing as designed. The field test was performed on September 8, 2011, and the spill readings were taken on February 22, 2012. These tests confirmed that the lighting system is performing as designed and the pole locations are correct. I have enclosed a copy of our readings to this letter for your review. As you can see, the readings that were taken on February 22, 2012 reflect a few tenths of a candle power at the property line. This reading can be compared to a full moonlight reading. We have been able to minimize the distance the lights travel off the playing surface through proper pole heights and the use of visor and all fixtures. Please let me know what else we can do to assist. And then there's the letter from Father Mark. That they've changed, you know, that when they're doing the practice, that they're going to have 75% lighting power. The lighting's going to be reduced to 75%. So.
Anybody else? Brian.
I will just say that I'm still interested in exploring that further as far as whether or not the lights that had been submitted actually did meet zoning regulations for full cutoff. I don't, I have to go back and look, but, you know, I may have made an error in recommendation. I'm not sure what the full.
What are you talking about, the night sky ordinance? That's for cutoffs?
Right.
Alan?
If I remember correctly, they also submitted the exact light fixture they were going to use and its performance criteria.
They did.
As part of that submission. So I see there's been no disguise of what they've been up to. If you look at the night and the lights are on, you can see light. That doesn't mean light is coming onto your property. You can see light from 100 miles away. No particular impact on you, but you can still see light. Now that they want to bring in their own experts and do all this kind of thing, I'd be hard pressed to do it without at least a public hearing.
Okay.
I mean, the discussions for one thing, but if you're gonna make decisions, something like that, you've got to have a public hearing. That would be my opinion. You can't eliminate the public from that discussion. If you decide to do that, I don't think it's necessary. You're the enforcement officer for the planning department, are you not? And if you find that the lights are not doing what they're supposed to doing, what is your course of action? Notify the owner that they need to correct it. And if they don't, what do you do then? And it becomes a civil action of the town against the landowner. Period.
So at this point, seems the most prudent course of action would be to turn this over to Brian to check the conformity at this point before we discuss it. If it's conforms to what was presented and has been approved. Is that, does the board concur with that statement?
I would think that you allow the abutting landowner to, if he wants to test and submit documents, let him do it. And he has that right. And if it's different than what we have, then you might have cause for concern. Otherwise, I would say you didn't.
I agree. He can certainly comment during public comment at the beginning of the meeting if he wants. But I don't know that we need to have a...
That would be something new. We don't actually have public comment.
We can write that into our rules and regulations.
No, I don't need new rules and regulations, but at the chairs.
We're gonna get some anyway. We're gonna put some forth. So,
John, you have anything to say?
No, I'm. I think it's past our jurisdiction to even act on this. It seems like it's the enforcement and.
No.
I mean, we can listen, but we can't really do anything to it without evidence.
I mean, unless there's something drastic that's misrepresented someplace or other, I don't know if it's something for us to revisit or if it's something that should go through enforcement.
Well, so I'd say I'll wait to find out what they want to submit as far as, you know, official documentation of complaint information and kind of take it from there.
They haven't given you anything yet?
They've submitted a letter of, you know, this is what the complaint is, but they're, you know, like I said, they want to have some tests done and that type of documentation. They haven't submitted anything like that.
So the board's decision is to let it be an action for Brian to handle at this point, and we'll get a further report from Brian. And if Brian deems it action is necessary, then we'll discuss it further. Everybody in agreement with that? Jeff was raising his hand, but I can't recognize you, Jeff, because there's no public hearing right now. All right, then. It's in Brian's hands until we hear differently from Brian. All right, the first item on the agenda tonight is under new business, is map 20, lot 16. It is a site plan, subdivision plan, time extension request for an approved plan to convert the use of the property to a mixed use development, which is the Dearborn Village project, and one new office building. Brian, could you give us a rundown on this, please?
Yes. Basically, the applicant has submitted their request. It came in timely. It was received on the 15th of November of February 2012. The board has granted in the past a time extension on this project.
How many?
Let's see. It was originally conditionally approved on 3/13/08. Has been granted three extensions to 2010, 2011, and then to 2012. This request would be to extend it to March 24th of 2013.
It would become the fourth extension.
That's right.
Okay.
Again, the reasoning from the applicant was that, you know, they have not been able to come up with the funding due to the economy. And so they've had to keep it on hold.
Has any of our zoning regulations changed that would affect this decision?
No, I don't believe so. Not since last year, not since we recently amended it, so.
All right.
Mr. Chair.
Please, John.
I did receive a phone call and a text from the applicant at around 5:45 or so, mentioning that she was violently ill with some sort of a food-borne thing, and she certainly sounded it. She wanted to be here, but she couldn't be here because she was just not capable of making it.
Duly noted. The only thing we've ever discussed over the last few extensions that I can remember are our drainage changes to the possible recharging of groundwater for our underground for drainage systems. Now, I don't know if we have discussed this in the past. Do you have any recollection, Phil or Alan, on this project? I don't think there was very much drainage to speak of on this project.
It goes to the brook that runs down
through some level spreaders.
Yeah, I mean, it was fine at the time. It's all mm-hmm. surface to get down to the brook that was pre-treated.
Okay.
And I just restated conditions of approval on your plan. I also included condition of approval that had been imposed the last extension, which was that, you know, the planning board also removed the 55 and older age restriction back on June 9th. And so that condition is now part of the overall approval for the plan. So that's right. Condition number 14 on your list.
Before we discuss this any further, I think we got ahead of ourselves. We need a motion for on staff recommendations number 1 and 2 before we can even really have any further discussion on this. Somebody say something.
I recommend that we approve staff recommendations number 1 and 2.
Motion by Mark for staff recommendations number 1 and 2.
Would you like me to read them for the record?
Please read them into the record, Mark.
No?
Well, you can.
Why don't
you
just read them into the record?
Find that the site plan subdivision plan time extension request does not have regional impact. That was one. Number two, accept this site plan / subdivision plan time extension as complete and ready for review.
Okay, Mark made the motion. Anybody second it?
I'll second that.
Seconded by John. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? And chair votes affirmative. Well, now, since the applicant has not here to make a presentation, but we have had representation from Brian as to the reasons why the request has been made. Now we're opening a public hearing at this time. Is there anyone here to speak to this matter? Okay, there's no one here to speak to the matter. We're going to close the public hearing. Okay, it's time for the board to discuss it, if there's discussion.
I would make a motion to extend this application to March, similar to the last
March years. 24th, 2013.
March 24th, 2013.
It's number 6 on the staff recommendations.
Yeah, similar to the motion that we made last year.
Exactly that?
Exactly. Approve a 1-year extension time to March 24th. To meet the approval conditions of the site plan subdivision plan listed below.
Okay, I second that.
Okay.
Can I make a suggestion?
You may. It's up for discussion.
Anything from the applicant?
Bill Ken is not here.
And this board has never voted to approve anything.
Sam.
Without having the applicant do a presentation. I might suggest that John withdraw his motion, have somebody else make it, and have him act as the applicant's representative, since the applicant did call him, and that you might abstain from the vote and act as the applicant in granting this extension. We would still have a quorum. we still have a quorum.
That's even more odd than what we're doing.
Yeah, well.
I know in the past, the planning board has made actions without people here.
We've had, Dennis Gerard was not able to make meetings and ask for extensions, as I remember, for the project on, am I wrong?
No.
I think Dennis Gerard was not able to make a meeting one night, and we accepted a correspondence from him because he was not able to make it.
And I don't believe the applicant has to be present in order for the planning board to make a determination on this. They've put in their application as is required.
Mm-hmm.
They've given us whatever kind of documentation they need to make the request, and it's up to the planning board to make the, you know, it's no different than if they got up here and said, well, you know, Brian's given you the presentation anyway, so I'll just sit back and wait for you to do your thing.
We have heard that in the past. Mm-hmm. Alan, would you have any other discussion on the matter?
No.
Okay. All right, so there's a motion by Mark, seconded by John. Do we need...
Well, vice versa.
Vice versa.
Oh, it was vice versa? Excuse me. Okay.
John made the... He read number six here, and I seconded it.
Okay. Brian, do we need to ask him to amend his motion to include all the previously imposed conditions of approval?
He
read that in.
He referenced it?
Did reference it.
Yeah.
And I'll include it in the minutes.
Okay.
1 through 14?
Mm-hmm. Well, listen below. Yes, that would be 1 through 14.
So everything has been included in the motion. You second it, Mark, as that?
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Any other discussion? Anybody want to discuss the motion? Okay. Seeing there's no discussion, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of granting a one-year extension to March 24th, 2013, please say yes.
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 Or whatever. Anybody opposed? Alan.
No.
Alan's opposed. Phil is opposed. The chair votes in the affirmative. So it's 3-2.
So the motion fails?
Motion passed.
Passes.
Yes. So 3 in favor, 2 against.
That's right. That's right. I'm sorry.
3-2.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Okay, the second item under new business is Map 5, Lot 56-2. It's a site plan amendment hearing to add an awning to the entrance of the Shell Station car wash facility. Owner is Tetro Drive. Owner's, what is this?
Applicant and property.
Oh, Tetro Properties is the owner. My mistake. Okay. Brian, could you give us a rundown on this, please?
Yes, Mr. Chair. We received this application for a 424-square-foot entrance awning to the existing car wash building at the Shell Station property located on 100 Mast Road. My recommendation in the staff report is that it does not pose a regional impact, and that the board accept this plan for review as a complete application. Key considerations. I went back through the record that has existed on this property and actually found an application that happened several years back that is essentially the same application. However, they're not proposing to put on a front awning. They just want the rear awning in this case. And so a question that had come up in my mind was, you know, has the board already, because the board's already denied something in the past on this, that was denied, by the way, and because the board has already denied something like this, is it
you know, a substantial enough, has there been any kind of substantial enough change on the property or the, in the rules and regulations to allow this to come back to the planning board for a new application? And looking at it, I made the determination that, yes, it is a substantial change. Number one, like I said, they removed the front awning request. And then also, number two, the zoning has changed on this property. It used to be industrial and agricultural, and now it's commercial industrial flex zone. And so I would say that that's enough of a change that, you know, it's not any kind of issue to review this plan again. There were no comments from any of the departments. Previously, the concerns had been, does it fit in with the original concept for the design of the car wash and the station? There were concerns that the project was designed more like a tent than an awning. Signage was a concern, whether or not there would be any signage on the exterior of the tent or the awning or whatever we call it. And then also just being compatible with our design review building form and compatibility section in our development regulations appendix G section 2D, which speaks to design guidelines that should be followed when putting up a canopy or other form of structure. One consideration that I took, and this was a large consideration that I took into account when making my recommendation, was that this is in the rear of the property, it's away from the street, most likely will not be very visible to passersby. And so in looking at it, my recommendation is to approve the site plan subject to four conditions, that the canopy graphics only say enter as is proposed on their plan, and that no additional signage be attached or fixed to the exterior of the canopy or to the windows on the canopy. Number two, that they provide their professional stamps and signatures. Number three, that they provide the digital files on AutoCAD. And number four, that the board's final decision be noted on the site plan, and all the approval conditions be noted on the site plan as well. And that's it. I've attached the minutes of the previous action by the previous board. That was back in 2004, September 23rd of 2004, just so that you can have that to review and see what their concerns were. But again, I mentioned those concerns in my report, and I just mentioned them. So, and I've also attached a photograph that had been in the file of what had previously been submitted. That's this one.
Is that photograph representative of what they want, Brian?
I believe it is, because it looks very similar as to the plans that they submitted in their application. It looks to be the same type of, they've got the blue strip on the bottom with the windows, and so for all intents and purposes, it looked to me that was the same type of tent or awning structure that they're now proposing. So, and you can see on that picture that there was one on the front where they're talking about, and in the rear. So as you exit the car wash, in this case they're only asking for the one to enter the car wash. And the reason that they're asking for is, you know, provide some protection for their equipment as you pull into the car wash. There's ground equipment that actually grabs your car and pulls you in, and you know, when it's snowing outside or whatever, you know, keep the elements off of that equipment. Hopefully that will protect it a little bit. And
we'll let them explain all of that when they make their presentation.
Okay, so For now, I guess the appropriate actions would be to determine that the site plan amendment doesn't have regional impact and accept the plan as complete, ready for review. That's my recommendation. And then allow for them to make their presentation.
Okay, so I'll need a motion on that.
I will move that we accept staff recommendation number one, that there's no regional impact, and the application is complete and ready for review.
So moved by Mark, seconded by?
I'll second.
Phil.
Phil seconded it. Any discussion of the motion? All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion passes. Okay, gentlemen, for your names for the record, please.
Good evening. I'm Anthony Guba with AUB Engineering, Exeter, New Hampshire, registered PE in the state of New Hampshire. With me is Thomas Healy, Director of Technical Services at Nuria Energy, also a professional engineer. As you stated earlier, the outline of the project has already been pretty much stated to you. What we're looking to do is just add a small 400 square foot awning over the entrance, basically to protect the equipment, the conveyor equipment that extends outside the building. It not only protects that equipment, it will provide some energy conservation in reducing the amount of heat loss in the building in cooler weather. It also reduces the overspray that could occur coming outside of that building and some of the spray into the surrounding area. And it'll protect the patrons a little bit when it's a little bit cooler out, because they have to stop at that to make their choice at the pedestal as to what kind of car wash they want to choose and to get the thing started. So there's a point of time where they have to roll the window down and they're sitting there. So this provides protection for that also. I did bring along a few photos. I also have all the presentation material on boards if I need to show it to you, but I know you have it in front of you, so unless you need me to, through the chair, I'll give you some photos and also my card for the secretary. I did make a presentation for this back in 2004, so I'm familiar with the site, and we have made some changes to it. The most dramatic is that we, at that time, were proposing to put it on the front of the building, so it would be pretty obvious to the street. At this time, we're only looking to do it at the entrance of the car wash, which is at the back of the building. The applicant is different. At that time, the site was controlled, and I was working for Motiva, Shell Oil, basically. The control of site now is Nuria, who has acquired a number of sites from Shell when they pulled out of New England. Nuria now controls the site, a smaller operation. Very interested in maintaining the location at a high standard, and found this year was a little bit warm, so it wasn't as much of a problem, but the previous years they found it's a big problem in the really cold weather, even when the car wash isn't operating, that external equipment is exposed to the weather. The fact that this faces away from the street, I know there were some concerns about it looking like a tent. I think that if you look at the building and the way that the awning attaches to it, I think that it really does fit in with the architecture of the building. The gas canopy out front, it's not something I think that's incongruous to the property and the use and the way that the location looks like. We're not making any changes. This is really a small project. We're not making any changes to grading on the site, landscaping, lighting, signage. We're not making any changes to screening of the property, the drainage, any of the runoff. We're not making any changes to the traffic patterns, the driveways, or any of that. So I know there's a number of waivers that we requested as far as the site plans a part of it. And that's basically because it's just a really small proposed addition of this awning. The way the awning will look most of the time is the way you see it in the photo, which is it's basically just open in a actually like a sunshade. When the weather's cooler, there's a stiff, clear plastic that will be fastened to the sides that will block wind from being able to fly through it. And so it won't look much different, but as you see there, it's, I think it fairly blends in. It really doesn't stick out too much. As far as the proposed conditions to the approval, I don't see anything on there that is adverse to what we were looking to doing. We're not looking to make this a sign, so there was no intent to add other graphics to it. As far as providing the PE stamps, digital files, and adding notes to the plans, that's not a problem at all. So we would have no problem at all with any of the suggested conditions. I guess that, you know, it isn't a big project. There isn't a lot to really talk about.
Brian, this applicant has mentioned waivers. Could you review the waivers, please?
I don't have the application itself in front of me, so I have to
there you go.
Ask for somebody to maybe
send it right down there. I mean, I thought they were listed here on our
sheet. I didn't actually see this when I went through the application, so I apologize for missing this when I put in my recommendations, but so they're asking for waivers of surveyor, wetland scientist, stamps or certification, site details not proposed to change, topo, lighting, signage, stormwater, utilities, snow removal. And then the reasons they're saying it's the proposal is for a very minor change to construct a 423, and I think it's 424 square foot awning at the car wash entrance to protect wet mechanical components from severe weather. This work will not impact previous site approvals and current site compliance with typical site plan requirements.
Does anybody have any discussion about the waivers? Okay, thank you, Brian. I just had a couple quick questions, if nobody else has any. Does this photo that you passed us out, is this an actual representation of the awning you want to install? Is it going to be exactly like that?
Well, I didn't take measurements of it, but I believe it's a very, very close.
The design, is it a round canopy
yes.
top?
Yes.
Type style awning?
Yep. Yeah, and we do show that. I mean, if you take a look at...
We don't want to discuss an awning that looks different from this photograph.
I don't know.
And it would be installed differently.
I understand. So when you're looking at it from the front, this is the awning which matches exactly as you have there with the same wording in it, this part right here, with posts on either side. And if you look at it from the side, this part is the dome part that's curving away from you. This would be the plastic part that is only there seasonally when it's cool. Otherwise, it's not there. So yes, it's exactly. I don't know this. You know, we're looking for one that's 15.6 by 27. That might be a foot too longer or shorter, but basically the design is the same.
The look
yes,
is what it's all about.
Exactly the same.
Alan?
Are the sides of the car wash painted this yellow and blue now?
Yes, actually, I think in the older photo that you have, and I submitted a photo with the application that shows the actual building that's there, and that signage that runs across the windows or the side of the car wash is what's there now, yes.
Well, actually, the photo you submitted is a white wall.
No, that's another location.
So you're saying that the walls now have this blue and yellow stripe on them?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
That's the rest of the building is white, but they do have that yellow and blue strip
around the sides. I can remember there was
sides.
A vast discussion on the colors of that service station. Numerous
yeah.
times in front of this board.
All right.
Yeah, and that awning will tie right into that. I mean, it's part of that.
Don't have to convince
approved.
Me.
I have three more. Brian, this would require a building permit from the building department?
Yes.
It would require to be inspected by the building inspector?
Yes.
And what are the snow loading calculations for an awning that you're going to leave up year-round? Can that awning withstand the weight of snow?
They're designed for that. We don't do that. That's a pre-engineered, prefabricated structure that comes from the manufacturer that, you know, they put these up all over the country, and they come rated for the area that they're put in. So they're not, it's not only rated for the snow loads here, but they're also rated for wind loads in Florida and other situations elsewhere. So yes, that would be provided at the time that a building permit application is made. If there's structural calcs or some proof of that, that needs to be added to it, that can be provided.
What would need to be provided? Absolutely.
Okay.
We can't approve it if the snow is going to collapse on the patrons.
That's typical for any building or structure that we ask for structural calcs for, you know, all of that. So that's part of the building permit application process.
Wants to be provided. Doesn't have to be a condition of our approval, Brian?
No.
Anybody else from the board have questions for the applicants? How about the color? Is that in keeping with the rest of the project? It seems to me personally a white awning would be much more in keeping with the building, because it's the building is the majority of that building is white, and it would be less visible. Alan?
You're looking at the minutes from 2004, with one of the approval comments was, canopy color should be white.
I'm looking at the, I'm just looking at the building right here. The building's white.
Okay.
God bless you.
Just as long as they can assure us that we won't end up on the front page of the Goffstown News with a bright blue canopy on the car wash, like we did with the bright orange canopy out front over the gas pump.
Well, is the blue canopy something that this applicant wants, has to be, or is this?
Mr. Chairman, we'd be willing to change that color to white. One of the concerns with that would just be the maintenance. So white wouldn't hold up as well to the dirt, to the conditions, weather conditions. But that's, you know, if the board insists that's something, a condition to meet approval, we would take a look at that, sure.
Could you tell me your name again, please?
My name is Tom Healy. I'm with Nerea Energy.
I think blue is fine. The blue and yellow stripes. Dunkin' Donuts just put in more pink and brown. I have no problem with that. You guys know best.
John, you have something?
I'm all set with this, as long as it...
Bill, do you have any comments?
No, I just don't agree with the applicant, though. The white does get to be a little dingy a little later. I think that the life of the blue is probably a little bit longer.
I don't have any problem with the blue either. I just raised the question.
Oh.
The old minutes. So I'm not going to hold him to what he just said.
So the consensus is the blue is fine. Any other issues to be brought up about this application from the board? Okay. Do we want to vote on this now or deliberate it at the end of the meeting?
Let's get out of the way.
We voted.
Yep.
Are you looking for a motion?
No. Do you have a public hearing yet?
Oh, yeah, that's probably a good idea. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman. I'll open a public hearing if anybody from the public has any comments about this subject. I see no shaking heads in the back. Well, I guess there's no one here to speak to this, so the public hearing is closed. All right, then, I guess we're looking for a motion here.
I would move that we approve the site plan amendment subject to conditions 1, 2, and 3 per Brian's memo.
Not 4.
I guess 4? That's... And 4, sorry, subject to conditions 1, 2, and 3, 1, 2, 3, and 4 as printed on the memo.
Brian, is there somewhere in this paperwork here that has this condition attached to the site plan so it becomes part of the existing site plan? This decision or this allowance,
amendment? Condition number 4 basically states that they have to note the decision of the board on the plan and all the other all the conditions. So those are listed on the site plan when it gets put onto formal. Is that what you're asking about?
I'm asking, are these conditions all going to be on a new plan that's submitted to us?
Yes.
So that it's filed?
It won't come to the planning board, but it'll be on the plan before the chairman signs it.
So we will have it documented on a plan somewhere?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so Mark has made a motion to for the site plan amendment subject to the conditions 1 through 4. Did anybody second that?
I'll second it.
Seconded by Phil. Any further discussion of the motion?
Do you want to add anything to there about that the color as presented is okay?
The board has not stated that they want anything different, so
okay.
The color is not actually stated anywhere in this document.
Not in the recommendations. I didn't feel it was necessary, so I didn't put it on as a condition.
Well, I think it should be stated, Brian, because not that these guys aren't going to do what they said, but I don't want to see a pink canopy there when we're not when we come back to the next meeting.
But
John.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And again, being new to the planning board, only a year now, is it really something that we, is it a normal practice for us to get involved with what color someone uses?
Yes, John, a lot of times.
On an approved structure that we've said is okay to have that?
Yes, John, we ask for architectural renditions of buildings often, and we see the colors are going to be presented on the buildings, and we either approve those colors or recommend changes to the colors. It happens with different buildings from time to time.
Correct, and we did that for Dunkin' Donuts' recent renovation. Those colors were presented to us, and we approved that plan as presented with those colors.
Another project comes to mind, John, was one that the CVS presented to go down where the King Lanes are. They came in with a cookie cutter CVS that was just this monstrosity with bright colors, and the board decided it didn't represent the town very well with the makeup of the other buildings, and colors were an issue on that particular project. And we've never approved it as yet, but it did come up in discussion, John. So yes.
Okay, thank you.
And it's a good thing to approve a color, because then what the applicant has represented is what we get, and we don't come back with egg on our face. So the applicant has represented they want a blue canopy. If it's in the record as such, then we can vote on it.
And if you want to add a condition of approval that states that the colors as presented shall be followed, that's an easy condition.
Don't we have a
condition of approval?
Another formal plan, though, that we were looking at, Alan?
Yeah, there is one.
Yeah.
It's in the plan.
Did it show blue?
Certainly.
Right. So if the plans have been presented, then we don't need to add the color because they're on the plan as presented.
Right.
Okay.
Does it say, though, as in our approval, are we saying as presented? I don't see anything in it that says as presented.
You can just say, you know, a condition of approval that color shall be as presented on the plans.
So we'll make that number 5.
See, what traditionally happens, Tim, is you only sign one drawing. It's not the rest of these, so these don't become a matter and they're not recorded. So it becomes a matter of if we can ever find them again in the archives. Right, or unless some member of the board's got it retained in the library of paperwork. So we have traditionally said the color has been stated if it became a matter of discussion.
So I would suggest, Brian, we add a 5 that states something simply like canopy color shall be as represented to the board.
Blue as represented to the board.
Well, blue plus a clear side or clear and whatever was on the base. What was on the base?
It was blue and clear plastic.
Clear. Yeah.
But there was yes, sir, go ahead.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, what we may actually look at doing is we're going to make the top part of it blue. The side panels, we've actually moved more to just to a fully clear panel, so
okay.
There's no color on the side. Mm-hmm. So this would be representative of the awning that we're going to put up, with the exception of maybe that bottom blue band. We would eliminate that and not have color down at the base of the side panels.
So is it fair to represent it as a blue canopy with clear sides?
Yes, sir.
So I would ask we add that as item number 5, Brian. Canopy color shall be as represented to the board, blue canopy and clear sides. Would you add that to your motion, Brian, Mark?
No, I won't, but I'll withdraw my motion.
Okay, Mark has withdrawn his motion. John, do you withdraw? Phil, do you withdraw your second?
Well, the motion's withdrawn, then second.
Well, it's just...
Well, if he, I have to withdraw my second before he...
Oh, you do?
Well, whatever. I'll withdraw it, but I'll make a motion to include the approval 1 through 5.
Okay, there's a new motion on the floor to include the number 5 in addition to 1 through 4 from Phil. Anybody want to second that motion?
I'll second it.
Seconded by Alan. Any discussion? Seeing none, I'll ask for a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
I was an aye.
John was an aye. Any abstentions? Chair votes in the affirmative. It passes unanimously. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Do you have a card?
All right, the next item on our agenda for tonight is map 3, lot 41 and 62-1. Site plan amendment hearing for Founders Green Commons, minor parking adjustments and relocation of gates. St. Anselm's College is the owner. Brian, could you give us a brief rundown on this?
Yes, Mr. Chair. The college, St. A's College, has previously been into the planning board with their Founders Green project that was approved last summer. And they have not gotten their plan signed or anything, but I think that was probably due to the assumption that they knew they might make a change. And so they are coming back to the planning board with some minor changes. What they're proposing basically is a plan to restrict vehicular access from the south side so that they wouldn't be able to come in to where the Founders Green is. The original plan had shown that they would be able to come in and kind of do a loop back and exit out. And what they'd like to do is gate off both ends so that vehicles have to either come in and go back out the same way or go around and come in and go back out the same way instead of doing a loop.
For those of us who don't know south from north on the plan, which way is south, Jeff? Is that closest to the main parking lot, or is that all the way around behind the skating rink and up on the back?
It's around the back. South is down here.
Okay.
So, and maybe Jeff could more easily explain what I'm talking about, but that's essentially the change. They're changing a few parking spots. They're removing a few parking spots where they had originally been, and then they're changing them from angled parking to 90-degree parking, and then they're moving those gates to close off the vehicular access to the Founders Green area. And, you know, I think that's essentially the change that they're talking about. You know, my recommendations are accept the plan as complete and ready for review, do the public hearing, and approve the amendment subject to the conditions as previously approved. I did add a condition at the end that emergency vehicle access, including access through the gates to the Founders Green area, shall be as approved by the fire department. And so that's one additional condition that I thought prudent, because they were going to be closing that access off to normal vehicles that they should. And they had previously, I think, worked that out with the fire department anyway, but just to kind of show that that's still going to be part of the approval. I think that was something that should be on there, so.
Okay, thank you, Brian. So we'll need a motion for item number one.
I'll make a motion that we determine the site plan amendment does not have a regional impact and accept the plan as complete and ready for review.
Seconded?
Sure, second.
Second by Mark. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Passes unanimously. Give your name for the record, please, Jeff.
Jeff Caban from TF Moran's office.
So this will just locate you on the property. If you don't recall, this is all the St. Anselm College land, town of Bedford and Gosstown line basically runs down this location along here. These fields are in Bedford, the majority of the campus in Gosstown. This is the ice arena football field. The buildings down here, this is what we're talking about, this center of the campus parking lot. Last fall, they constructed a new parking lot right here in Bedford, which basically will replace those spaces. The idea is center of campus, upper campus, significant grade change. What they've done is they've put an elevator in this building, so now you can come in the upper part of this building, get in the elevator, come down. As far as ADA access, they're trying to make the campus more accessible for pedestrian activity. They've always talked about this being a quad, so you have less car traffic going through the campus where the kids are walking, dining facility is here, all that activity on by pedestrians is down there. So the idea is make that a green, built the parking lot already. This is the plan that you previously approved, and what we had was the gates were here so that traffic could circulate in front of the ice arena and in front of this Baruti Hall, which is a dormitory. The decision basically was they did not want car traffic, you know, approaching this area. So what they've done is move the gate back here, turn this parking to 90 degrees and move this gate out there. Again, keeping that whole area as pedestrian. So the before and after, you can see no real changes out here. We eliminated the parking spaces there. Turn these 90 degrees because you pick up a few extra parking spaces instead of being angled, since this is now going to end at the gate. What they will do, you know, the intention with these gates, and we've met with the fire department, they will be accessible for fire department to come in and make any circulation they wish. Moving in, moving out of the dormitories, they would open the gates, traffic control for students to move in, unload, move out, and then gates are closed the rest of the time. So that basically there's 13 parking spaces here with a gate there, which gives me 13 spaces associated with, again, the science building that, again, provides this upper to lower campus pedestrian access. I have handicapped parking spaces here and here. I've added some at this location because I wanted to get some parking relative to this dormitory. I provided a little sidewalk through there that wasn't there on the first plan. So predominantly what I've done is move those gates, eliminate that parking there, and turned this parking, so I'm adding, you can see I'm adding about 5 feet of pavement to get 90 degree parking in there. Total number of spaces is basically the same, no real change. There's no intention no intention of changing anything else associated with, you know, the green, the lighting that was associated with it, or what have you. So I'll turn it back to the board, and if you have questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
Thank you, Jeff. Anybody have any questions for Jeff? Phil?
Just, will you change the parking from the angle to the, to 90?
Yep.
I'm assuming that the turning radiuses, there's no problem with it.
Correct. The pavement widening was enough to get me a two-way access aisle as well as, you know, a full, I think there are 18 and a half foot deep spaces.
Okay.
Okay, Phil?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Ellen?
How's that?
Jeff, what's the net change in parking? Did you add or did you lose? You said it's close.
I think I'm down three spaces total on campus.
But you were, no problem.
No, basically what we've done, there's a campus parking plan in there. We have a total of 2,002 parking spaces on campus. This parking plan was developed specifically, we started using it when we did the football stadium. So what you're doing is we give a number of students, a number of faculty, and then tried to blend in special events. Okay. So normally on campus, during a normal event, you'd need about 1850 is what they have. And what they do for graduation and whatnot, they have what they consider overflow parking areas during football games and so forth. What they've done in the past, some of the football games they've actually parked in this front lawn area. They also, this used to be the temporary housing, which was the trailers. This probably dates back a while. This is a big flat grass area that they can park on. In addition to that, this is what they call the meadow, and that could hold a lot of overflow parking. So what they've done is they've gone to these areas when they have a large event. And I think their parking plan also shows they put flag people at certain points and what have you, and that's all depicted on that plan. So there is no issue as far as number of parking spaces.
Brian, I see you, the request to waive the 65-day clock for additional review. Are you going to do some TRC with fire and police on this or not?
No.
So are you still requesting the waiver of the 65-day clock?
You know, that may have just been something that I didn't change in my application. I don't know that you request to waive it.
We've pretty much addressed the previous comments, all
and I don't believe we need to push it out to any additional time. The 65-day clock is,
that's fine.
You know, a request to act within 65 days, and if they waive it, then that allows the planning board to drag it out for longer. But I don't think this has to be dragged out for any longer. So, I don't think that's even necessary.
And their intention is to build this summer.
Jeff, I have a question for you regarding the parking. You deem that the parking up on the left side of the project there that you've taken out right there,
yeah,
because of traffic flow was an imminent danger, obviously, the reason why. Why is it this parking on the right side of the project is not dangerous? Students are still going to be accessing those areas.
Well, basically what they wanted to do, again, we're gated here and we're gated here. They wanted to put a few parking spaces there specifically for, again, we have a couple handicap and so forth, access to the lower level of that science building. They didn't want to leave it because the nearest parking would be down here. And it was a pretty good grade change. I mean, it meets ADA, but it's still a pretty good hike from that lower area.
So it's your opinion that it's not a problem having parking in that area?
Right.
For safety reasons?
No. I mean, again, we've gated, and what we've done is we've shaped these gates such that, you know, they're a decorative gate, but you couldn't get by it, and there's a gap in the middle that the pedestrians can go through, and then the fire department will open it up as needed.
Now, has fire given any opinions on this at this time?
They haven't.
Are you going to seek their opinion, or is Jeff taking care of that?
No.
We met with them on campus before. Their circulation hasn't changed as far as, I mean, we've moved those gates, but their circulation, as you know, we've set this such that a vehicle can get in and get through and around all this. These are 16-foot wide walks or drives, whichever you want to call them. They have complete access in and out around the site.
Now, in the wintertime, how do you maintain those laneways so that vehicles are accessible?
Again, what's nice is they are 16-foot wide, and they'll be able to run there. You know, they're going to maintain their primary walkways anyways, but the college will maintain all these walkways.
And that's something that fire, has fire ever brought that up?
They haven't ever brought that up to my knowledge. And honestly, I think, again, part of the reason why I added that additional condition of, you know, making sure that fire department could have gate access is, you know, just for that additional note on the plan that verifies that, yeah, they are going to provide that.
It is absolutely clear. I mean, we actually discussed, some of the people at the college wanted a narrower walkway, pavement, okay, thinking that it was more attractive having less pavement. I don't think the 16 feet is going to seem disproportionate to the size of the screen myself, but some of them wanted to talk about it, and we actually discussed it with the fire department. If we went to a reinforced earth type of setup, which is, I don't know if you've seen it, but it's like a honeycomb chamber that you put in the ground and you plant grass on it, and you can drive over it. We asked them if in fact that would be acceptable to the fire department, and they said it'd be acceptable as long as everybody understands you plow it. And so if it, you know, you tear up the grass or you do anything to it, they don't care. They have to be able to drive on the thing. So it is absolutely crystal clear that these have to be maintained all the time. Basically, the fire connection, if there was an issue at these two buildings, an actual fire, they would come across the back because those hookups are in the rear of the building. But if you know, there's an incident where they got to get to a person and take them out, they're coming to the front of the building and, you know, in the front doors. And,
I only bring it up because you are replacing a parking lot which had unfettered access to the building, so the fire apparatus, and it was always plowed.
Correct.
I just want to be sure that it has been discussed with fire, and you seem to have covered that.
If you want me to verify with them, I can.
Sure, fine. Anybody else have any questions for the applicant? I'll open the public hearing at this time. Anybody from the public wish to question or make comments on this application? No one is here. I'll close the public hearing. Members of the board?
I'll make a motion to approve the site plan amendment subject to the conditions.
I'll second that.
1 through 12.
Thank you. Second.
So the 12th condition, Brian, regarding fire department, that would be, what's the proper word for that, Alan? Subsequent or precedent condition?
Subsequent.
So that would be a subsequent condition. Make sure the fire department has had their say and everything is in their agreement with them?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, motion by Phil to approve. Anybody want to second that?
I'll second it.
Seconded by Mark.
Mr. Chair, I don't recall, did we actually go through the acceptance and regional impacts?
We did.
Yes.
Okay.
We did.
I'm sorry.
Yep.
Thank you.
Okay, Brian. So it's been, motions are made, have been seconded. Any discussion of the motion?
Yes, please. A couple Mark. Questions here. Number 8, it says, verify if the VersaLock wall will receive a protective coating to prevent salt degradation. So I'm wondering why that's even in there. It seems a bit of micromanaging, and to verify requires, and requires somebody on our part to go out and see that it's there. Shouldn't we just make that recommend or even remove it altogether? I would think It's up to the installers. If they think it's the right thing to do, they would do it without our requiring it.
Brian, where did that come from?
That is a comment from Megan.
Okay.
And I believe that she was just asking them to verify prior to planning approval that the wall would receive a protective coating.
Did she offer a reason for that?
Sure.
I could tell you one.
In order to prevent salt degradation. I mean, that's the reasoning.
Bill?
Because otherwise you'll have a wall that looks like the one in front of French and Rising that was replaced.
Yeah. And the wall becomes unstable at that point.
Correct.
It's a stability issue, not more than a visual issue.
Right. It's it leads to a safety issue.
That's where I was going with it. Okay.
That's what I wanted.
It's prudent upon us to do that, and knowing this, and it's a recommendation from the Public Works engineer, who's a PE.
Mark, do you have any other comments on that one?
No, I still don't think it's appropriate to be in here. For the record, I'll just put that in there. Next question, number 9, it says recommend spot grades on the riprap overflows. What are those? What's a spot grade? Or should it be grates?
I'm going to let Jeff answer that question.
Basically, it's just making sure a specific elevation is shown on that overflow. So it's a stone swale where if I had something that exceeded any normal storm, it's going to go out this riprap area or stone area. So she just wanted a specific elevation shown on that.
That's a design element of the drainage system.
Is this requiring that it be shown on the plans?
Yeah.
Is that what they mean? Okay. Thank you.
Any other comments, Mark?
No.
Okay. Anyone else have any other discussion on the motion to approve the site plan with conditions 1 through 12? Okay, we'll call for a vote. All those in favor of approving the site plan amendment subject to conditions 1 through 12? Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Chair votes yes, so it's a unanimous decision.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you.
All right.
So, Chair, before you end the meeting, I have a couple more things.
I was looking at your packet here to make sure we covered things. Do you want to lead with them, Brian, so I don't have to dig?
Well, I just wanted to introduce the two people that are sitting in the audience. We have Richard Meany and Brian Hansen. Both are possibly going to be on the planning board. They were among the applicants along with Alan Yeaton and Steve Dutton. And just wanted to, let them maybe have a chance to introduce themselves to the planning board.
Okay. Would you guys like to do that, or would you like to enjoy your anonymity? Come on up to the microphone.
I think Brian's introduction was adequate.
Yeah. What a way of being put on the spot, right?
I don't mind at all, but everybody wants to get home, right? So I definitely, you guys don't want to hear about me.
8:30 at night for planning board meeting?
That's good.
That's like record time.
So. Oh, you are not.
Take your no-dos.
You are not talking me into this too well.
Go ahead.
His name with an E or an O?
E.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Brian Hansen. I am a 12-year resident of Goffstown, New Hampshire. And I live here with my family and three children, my wife and three children. And I'm a real estate investor, and I also own a company called Granite State Environmental that deals with hazardous materials and a variety of abrasive blasting services. And I would be happy to tell you folks anything else that you're curious and dying to know.
Boy, I think you summed it all up.
Welcome to the crowd.
Thank you, Mr. Eaton.
We will have fun.
Thank you.
Oh,
I'm Richard Meany with an E, not an O. And subject to the board of recount, I may or may not be here at the next meeting. If there's anything you want to know, please let me know.
Short and sweet.
Thank you, both of you, for coming up to the plate. All right, Brian, correspondence and FYI, is there anything important?
I have one other item. I think we went through whatever correspondence and FYI that we need to. However, something that wasn't on the agenda is I received a letter that needs to be discussed in a non-public session.
Okay.
So I guess.
Well, since you know the RSA, when we get to it, I'll let you make the motion.
Right.
When the time comes.
Right, when we're finished with our public business.
Right.
When the time comes. But we can't adjourn the meeting and go into non-public. Is that correct, Phil?
Right. You have to keep the meeting open.
That's what I thought.
Go to non-public, and then once you come out, then you can adjourn the meeting, correct?
That's the way it usually is, does. All right. Does anybody have any other business before the board? Okay, Phil.
I just want to wish everybody good luck on Sunday.
Thank you.
It'll be fun.
Oh, I'm sure.
I've never been to a recount before.
I will.
So
have fun.
I will represent the planning board at the recount for the recount meeting. All right. Phil, would you like to make an appropriate motion?
I'll make a. What's the.
I know what the RSA is.
What provision?
There's an RSA.
Yeah,
you've
yeah.
got a quote.
I brought it just so that we would have it.
Which one it is.
This is Catherine's handy dandy.
Yeah, but which one is it? What are we going in for?
I
don't even know what it is.
So
we
thank you, guys.
It's a letter regarding a case that the planning board was under.
Get the,
legal things.
Yeah.
Okay. That's
enough
said.
I'll make a motion to enter non-public RSA 91:A:3, Roman numeral 2, and it's going to be E, legal claims.
Want to cite the RSA again, please?
RSA 91-A,
yep.
:3, Roman numeral 2.
Okay, thank you.
And it's going to be E, small e.
Okay.
Legal claims.
All right, Phil's made a motion. Anybody want to second Phil's motion?
Second.
Seconded by Mark. Any discussion on the motion?
Yeah, I remember they had a problem with the selectmen maybe a few weeks ago on this, so hopefully we're in compliance with that small letter E. I haven't read the RSA.
It was no problem with the meeting.
Okay, well, we're going in for a legal, something to do with this, a legal problem with the town or something like that. Is that why we're going into closed session?
We don't need to discuss that right now, Mark. We just need to make
the
sure.
The reason
right,
is just E. But I just want to make it for the record, since the statement was said the selectmen went in illegally. We did not.
All right. We're not going to discuss this any further about the illegality of any selectmen's decisions. We have a motion to go into non-public. Does somebody want to second the motion?
Mark did second it.
Mark did second. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All those in favor of going into non-public, say aye.
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 Opposed?
Now we need a roll call.
Opposed? You're opposed?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Alan is opposed. Chair votes in the affirmative. Now,
reason
what do we...
is I
roll
don't
call.
Believe in... It's okay. A roll call vote, right?
Now we have a roll call. Yes.
So could you please advise me on how to properly do a roll call?
Just ask for a roll call. I'm voting yes.
Okay. Roll call on vote. Phil?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
Tim is yes. Alan?
No.
Alan is no. So move. We will go into non-public. So could you please turn on...